this final lecture of Module 3, I'm going to pick up on a theme that I started developing in the previous lecture on economic policy and explain why it is that the current relationship between Congress and the executive branch, especially on economic policy, exists, where it came from, the deriving dynamics for it, and what we can expect from the future. So the diagram behind me here shows, you know, Congress and the executive branch and a couple of connections between them. These are not the only connections that exist between these two branches of government, but for the purposes of economic policy, these are the two that are relevant. Now, I just want to note here that there's Congress, the House and the Senate, and that's all there is to it, right? Now, we know from previous lectures that there are complex diagrams that show all the committees and the legislative process and how it all functions, and so this diagram could be seen to be much more complex, and it is, but for the purposes of this lecture, Congress is essentially just a simplistic entity that is, as I've said many, many times, status quo oriented. The obstacles to passing important legislation are numerous. Its main activity is its annual responsibility to pass a budget. It's very difficult to pass a meaningful reform to any existing legislation. It's very even more difficult to create a new program or a new statutory regime of any kind. So Congress is hamstrung from the beginning by design. It has it is intensified by partisanship. It's intensified by social media and the kind of performative politicking that is now a common feature of the 21st century. But from the 18th century onward, the Congress has been a status quo oriented institution by design, mostly by design, but also somewhat unintentionally. Now, the executive branch initially, at its initial construction, was very small. It was the only executive officer mentioned, or executive officers mentioned, of the president and the vice president, and everything else is left up to Congress. What the executive branch looks like is a result of 200 plus years of accumulated congressional authorization. The reason why we have a Department of Homeland Security is because after the 9/11 terrorist attacks, Congress reorganized the national security structure of the federal of the executive branch. The reason why we have the Department of Education, the Department of Health and Human Services, the Department of Housing, the Department of Energy is because in the 1960s, with the Great Society's expansion of programs, Congress also created a variety of new cabinet positions. The reason we have the Environmental Protection Agency is because Congress reorganized scattered environmental enforcement agencies into one Environmental Protection Agency. Now, the reason why it's the Environmental Protection Agency instead of the Department of Environmental Protection is because Congress chose to make the EPA an executive agency, not a cabinet department. And this distinction is really important in general for understanding American politics, but it's important also for understanding economic policy outsourcing. Cabinet departments are hierarchical in their structure. They're headed by a cabinet secretary who is appointed and can be fired by the president. And below that it are appointed policymakers, and below that are bureaucrats, civil servants. It's very hierarchical, and in most cases, the president can exercise whatever level of micromanaging he or she wants to exercise over the way a cabinet department runs, through the issuing of executive orders, presidential memos, mostly through appointing and keeping and not firing political appointees who will do the president's bidding. So this side of the executive branch is one where the president has a lot of control. And this is on purpose, right? Congress created these cabinet departments to be directly under the control of the president so that it could enforce and implement policies. Cabinet departments are largely, while there is policymaking power in them, because there really is a lot of policy that can be made in the details of enforcement and implementation. What the tax forms look like, how the tax schedules are drawn up by the IRS. These, while they're not a ton of policymaking power because tax rates are set, it gives a little bit of discretion to the IRS, how they decide to audit, which kinds of entities do they look for, big companies, for wealthy people, do they look for middle class freelancers. There's policy making power in those enforcement decisions as well. and I could multiply the examples 1,000 times, but there's not a ton of policymaking power when what you're doing is making decisions about enforcing and implementing government's decisions. Now, I put budget here because budget is actually key to both enforcement and implementation. The more money you have, the more effectively you can enforce a law in the books. The less money you have, the less you can. If the Civil Rights Division of the Justice Department has 2 lawyers versus 50 lawyers, that's going to mean that it can handle fewer or more civil rights complaints and therefore enforce the very Civil Rights Act that are under its jurisdiction more or less effectively. So budgets are key. Of course, the what you're enforcing or implementing, right? If you're the Department of Health and Human Services and you're implementing the Affordable Care Act's subsidies for healthcare exchange payment premiums, then your implementation is also going to be based on the budget. If there's more money for that or if there's less money for that. If there's more money for people to do it, it's going to happen more quickly. If there's less money, it's going to be less efficient and some people are going to fall through the cracks. So, but what you're enforcing and implementing comes from statutes. Now, I don't put statutes up here because that I think that that's kind of just, maybe I shouldn't say it's obvious because nothing is obvious, but that's the underlying feature. Everything the executive branch is doing is based on some kind of statute. Now, part of the reason why this is directly under the control of the president is because this is really the classic thing that we think the executive branch is supposed to do in the theory of the separation of powers. Enforce and implement, right? That's what executive power, you execute the laws that are passed by the legislature. This other side of the executive branch, and I've put a kind of a bizarrely shaped diagram box here, and that's because the agencies within this side of the executive branch are shaped in very many different ways. Some of them are really big, like the Environmental Protection Agency and the CIA, the Postal Service, which is a government corporation, not even an executive agency, but that's a type of executive agency. They come in many shapes and sizes. The FCC has 5 board members. The Environmental Protection Agency has an administrator and a bunch of political appointees and a bunch of scientists and bureaucrats. They're all differently shaped, differently sized, and they are differently organized and authorized. They all are involved in regulation and enforcement. And some of them actually enforce their own regulations. Some of them enforce a combination of their own regulations and the regulations that are passed by Congress. And that's really the much more common thing. But I put regulation first because it is the most important function of most of these executive agencies. They have regulatory power either to make up regulations from scratch, like the FCC has the power to regulate the communications industry, the telecommunications industry in the United States. That's a pretty vast and obviously stupendously important policy domain. Congress can always, this is something that I've said before and I just want to keep saying it again and again because it is really true and it's important to know, can always override or repeal a regulation passed by an executive agency. And in fact, if within 60 congressional days of a regulation being implemented, Congress has a fast track to repealing it. After that period expires, Congress has to undergo the normal legislative process. In other words, they have to pass a law that passes with a majority in both houses of Congress, probably a filibuster-proof majority in the Senate, and be passed or signed into law by the president, or have enough votes to override the presidential veto to change or repeal or amend a regulation. And that's a cumbersome process. So functionally, these agencies have a lot of independent discretionary power to set regulations. And there are so many more federal regulations than there are federal statutes. And that's actually one of the reasons why this has happened. Why this transfer through statutory authorization, right? First you create an agency and then you create a bunch of laws for it to enforce and to fill out with regulations. Or you actually, a lot of times there's an authorizing statute and there's an enforcement regime in the cabinet department and Congress decides to move that over to an executive agency. And that's what happened with the EPA. There were a variety of different cabinet department agencies, sub-agencies, that were handling different parts of environmental regulation enforcement, and it was it was a mess. It was a hot mess, and there was a lot of duplicated effort, there were a lot of cracks,
And so under President Nixon actually proposed a reorganization of the environmental regulatory regime and centralizing it all into an agency. Now, interestingly, and this isn't directly relevant to economic policy, though environmental policy definitely touches on economic development via restrictions and compliance costs that I talked about last time, but Nixon wanted the Environmental Protection Agency to actually be a cabinet department because he wanted direct control over it. He wanted to be able to issue executive orders and hire and fire the Secretary of Environmental Protection, etc. Congress actually created the EPA as an executive agency because presidents only have indirect control over those, mostly through appointments. And in some cases, the president can fire as well as hire the people who had these agencies, and the EPA is one such. But in some cases, the president can only appoint, and then the people who are in those positions are immunized from being removed, except under extraordinary circumstances, and that usually doesn't happen. Donald Trump tried to remove or threatened to remove a bunch of people, but you have to have cause, and if you're actually doing your job according to the statutory requirements of that job, then the president can't just remove you, or if he can remove you and you can protest and be reinstated, and that's part of the checks and balances system. Again, this is not a class in the presidency or the executive branch, so I won't get into the details of that. But these agencies are more immunized from presidential control than cabinet departments are. And so when Congress has decided to transfer some of its power, it has almost always transferred its power over to this side out of a combination of necessity and caution, right? The necessity is that, okay, we know that the legislative process is slow, it's obstacle-ridden, there's only so much that the 435 members of the House and 100 members of the Senate can do, and this is an important policy area, and we need to have more regular updates to it. We need to have greater focus, greater expertise, greater efficiency of policymaking and policymaking changes. We can't do that here in Congress. So we're gonna pass that on to the executive branch. I almost said pass the buck, but it's not really passing the buck. It really is a responsible and rational transfer of fundamental policymaking power in to somewhere where it can be done well. Now, as always, and I've said this again and again, but it's definitely merits repeating, Congress can always change that. It can always revoke a regulatory mandate. It can always dissolve an executive agency. It can always move an executive agency into a cabinet department or pull back that policymaking power into Congress itself. So there is no fundamental danger in doing this. Of course, as always, with a status quo-oriented Congress, it is very difficult to do that, and it usually requires some kind of crisis or some kind of major political shift to have that kind of transformation take place in the body of executive agencies. Congress is better at repealing regulations than it is at actually revoking statutory mandates. It's easier to say, okay, we don't like these few things that the executive agency is doing, let's change that kind of thing. That's happened, for example, with the FCC makes a ruling and Congress is like, oh, telecommunications policy is really important, we want to have a hand in this, and so they will change some of those regulations through what I would consider to be the normal override process. An executive agency passes a regulation, Congress doesn't like it, it overrides it either by repealing it or by passing an amended version of it. So the transfer of power to these executive agencies is done really for, I would say, responsible reasons. And the very fact that it's put, that most of this policymaking power is put here, where the president has only indirect control at best, versus here, where the president actually has a high level of control over the way these cabinet departments are run, is out of caution that there's not a shift of power from the Congress to the president. Because there's a difference in shifting power from Congress to the executive branch, which is diffuse, and shifting power from Congress to the president, which is a single person who can, if given new levers of power, will absolutely use those levers of power. Presidents are always seeking to make the most effective use of the levers of power they have, as well as expand that toolkit of levers of power, if at all possible. So out of both a necessity as well as caution, this is the direction where, through statutory authorization, policymaking power is moved. And as I indicated last time, and I'll just tell it again to reinforce it, the beginning of this transfer from Congress to the executive branch, not the president, but to the executive branch, really began in earnest in 1913 with the passage of the Federal Reserve Act, where Congress created a brand new, large, extraordinarily powerful, and extraordinarily important institution, the Federal Reserve System, which includes a variety of regional banks, it includes the Central Committee, it includes numerous other kind of sub-agencies that have their own sources of appointment and power. People are appointed to the Federal Reserve System from the banking industry itself, from through the presidency and through internal appointments. It was the first one that was created, and it was created utterly out of necessity. Monetary policy cannot be made in Congress, and up until 1913, monetary policy wasn't being made except in this way. Congress kept the United States on the gold standard. Money could only be printed, the executive branch could only print money if it had gold to back that money. The gold standard was a problematic way of conducting monetary policy in a fast-growing, increasingly diversifying, increasingly interdependent national economy. And so the gold standard was kept for a long time, but when you create a Federal Reserve Bank that can actually manipulate monetary policy and interest rates through more than just printing money, there are other mechanisms besides the either printing lots more money or printing way less money to control the size of the money supply. Congress actually decided, okay, we want monetary policy to be done in a rational way by people who actually understand the needs of the financial system to grow our economy in a slow, steady, and sustainable way. Because prior to that, the U.S. economy was subject to booms and busts of a very severe nature and on a cycle that was, while not predictable in terms of when it was exactly going to happen, but it was predictable that it was going to happen. And of course, we had the Great Depression, so we still have had cycles of depression and recession. But ever since the Federal Reserve System was created, that has been largely avoided, the more extremes, and softened. And the big failure, the Great Depression, actually was a failure of the Federal Reserve to do its job effectively, but a lot was learned from that, both by people operating within the Fed as well as by members of Congress who passed an awful lot of new regulations on economic behavior. But the Federal Reserve was first created to do a job that Congress knew it couldn't do itself, and it was created on, and it wasn't put into this side of the executive branch. This side of the executive branch was essentially created when the Fed was created, and over the course of the 100 plus years since 1913, this side of the executive branch has grown. This side has grown as well, right? There were only like 6 cabinet departments in 1900, and now there are 15 cabinet departments. There was no Department of Energy, no Department of Education, no Department of Health and Human Services, no Department of Health, Education and Welfare, Housing and Human Services, sorry, not Health and Human Services, I always mix those up. There was no Department of Homeland Security. There was no Department of Defense. There was a Department of the Army and a Department of the Navy and a Department of War, if you can believe that. It wasn't until after World War II that the Department of Defense was created to centralize our national security apparatus, just like the Department of Homeland Security was created after 9/11 to transfer things from various agencies. This side has grown. This side was created and has grown for the very reason that more and more policy domains came into federal vision, right? The federal government started doing a lot more things in the early 1900s and definitely starting in the 1930s. Both the 1900s and the 1930s were times when progressive policies expanded the scope of government interaction with all aspects of American life and really all aspects of the economy. When you are regulating food supply to schools, that's an important component of economic activity. When you are regulating the environment, that's an important part of economic activity. When you're regulating the energy sector, when you're providing money for education, all of these things have economic impacts. So partly the expansion of the policy scope of the federal government has been driven by this underlying concern that is a bipartisan consensus that this is what the federal government should be doing to make sure that the economy is healthy, stable, and growing. as I indicated last time, of course, the two parties have different economic philosophies and different particular policy prescriptions that they believe will do that job the best, but they agree. It's not as though one party says the economy should be on its own and the other party says, no, we need to be shepherding the economy. Republicans want to have government policy that's going to promote the best kind of economic development. They just tend to have a less government intervention, more free market view on what will do that. But they share the Democrats' view that the federal government and the policies that it makes should be aimed fundamentally at making sure that we have a stable economy, a growing economy, a productive economy, and that prosperity is constantly expanding and spreading out through the American people. Policy disputes within this consensus obviously are extraordinarily important, but one of the things that has happened as a result of this consensus of concern is more and more creation of agencies that fit here with regulatory power that gives them the ability to create restrictions, as well as by creating restrictions, you create compliance costs. Now, Republicans don't like compliance costs because they see that as moving money away from investment and innovation. Democrats don't mind compliance costs, even though they also accept that compliance costs can slow innovation and investment, because they believe that compliance costs are important to promote other economic goals like fairness and security and equity. And so the biggest dispute really now shifts from, should we be doing these jobs? Yes or no, which was an argument in the 19th century and into the early 20th century, to how should we be doing these jobs and what kinds of underlying values. The Republican conservative view is that the economic policy ought to be driven by fundamentally by freedom and efficiency and the private sector, and the Democratic or liberal view is that economic policy ought to be driven by security and equity growth. And they both actually agree on growth, I should say. So what are the underlying economic values that drive economic policy? Now, because executive agencies are staffed by appointees of the president, Congress, by shifting the center of gravity of economic policymaking and really all policymaking across to this side of the executive branch, does make it tremendously important who the president is, even when the president doesn't have direct control, because when you can appoint a bunch of people, then you're going to be able to have a bigger influence than, your party will have a bigger influence on policy orientation in executive agencies than the party that's not in power. But the other thing, and I didn't put budget here, but budget also impacts these agencies as well. The Securities and Exchange Commission, its budget is an extremely important part of how well it can actually enforce its own regulations as well as the underlying authorizing statutes. So there is increased importance to the presidency, even though Congress has shifted this economic policy making in a way that would, as much as possible, immunize it from direct presidential control. But there still is the budget fight, which has a big impact on these executive agencies. So we've definitely seen a shifting in the center of gravity away from Congress and towards the executive branch. But that hasn't necessarily meant a shifting of power to the president. It shifted the importance of the presidency, for sure. It's heightened the importance of who wins the presidential election. The bigger the executive branch gets, well, even if it gets mostly bigger on this side where there's indirect influence, it still matters. You would still rather have, if you're a Republican president, and if you're a Democratic president, even if that president can't pull the levers of these agencies as clearly and as directly as they can pull the levers of the cabinet departments. So what has really resulted is that presidential politics have become increasingly important to policy outcomes, as Congress has, I think, by being responsible and cautious, right? When you shift power to this place, that's actually being relatively cautious and being responsible at the same time. So I hope that point is well made, is that this shifting has been done not because Congress are a bunch of cowards or because they're lazy. Elected officials don't want to give up power willingly. They don't give up power willingly. They only give up power out of a sense of necessity. And I would say one of those driving necessities over the past 100 years has been this necessity of responsible, efficient, timely policy making rather than keeping everything in your hands and doing a bad job of policy making. Congress has said, okay, in order for a policy to be done effectively, we're going to have to shift it over. That has, however, made it way, way, way more important who the president is. It's one of the reasons why presidents in the post-New Deal era, which is really when the bulk of this has happened, are a lot more high profile. It's not just that they're more recent and so we remember them more. It's that they actually have more control over outcomes, right? Franklin Pierce, if you can even remember that he was a president, Franklin Pierce was a mid-19th century president. He didn't do a whole lot because there wasn't a whole lot that was available to him to do. So it really kind of mattered a whole lot less. I almost said it didn't matter at all, but of course it matters who the president is. But it mattered less that Franklin Pierce was the president over the guy he beat. I don't even know who the heck he beat. Ever since the New Deal, with the expansion of the executive branch relative to the size of the legislative branch, who the president is has been increasingly consequential, and now it is, you know, the single most consequential choice. Of course, always the president has been one office holder with a lot of power, but it was less consequential who the president was throughout much of American history. That is no longer the case, and it is almost certainly not going to ever go back. No matter how much Congress could overcome its gridlock and sort of get back to some kind of pragmatic, bipartisan, compromising legislative behavior, it's still going to be slow. It's still not going to be able to take back a ton of power from these executive agencies for the very reason that the reason why that power shift in the first place hasn't gone away. The world has not become less complex, less fast-paced, less interdependent. And an institution of 535 people in two separate bodies that have to agree, but the majority on all policies, that has not itself become an easier, more efficient type of system. Even if we got rid of all of the sort of things that seem the most unhealthy, particularly partisanship and uncompromising ideological bubbles between Democrats and Republicans, even if we erase that, it doesn't mean that Congress is going to suddenly be central to the broad policymaking process anymore. It's still probably going to mostly be dealing with the annual budget. And as I indicated earlier, that is not an inconsequential thing. The way the budget is set, where money is spent and how much money and in what particular places that money is spent, have huge policy implications. And so it can look like Congress is really receding to the corner, but it has actually moved away from the real center of gravity of where policymaking happens, but not necessarily by cowering it in the corner. By, I would say, taking the place that it probably deserves in the overall policymaking system in a highly complex world where we do expect the federal government to be involved in every policy area. We don't necessarily, some people do, but we don't necessarily want the government to just stop being involved with energy policy, stop being involved with education policy, stop being involved with healthcare policy, and just, you know, abolish these agencies and then give up and leave it all to the states or leave it all up to the private sector. We Americans, both conservatives and liberals and moderates, expect the federal government to make policy that's going to promote economic growth, security, broad prosperity, certainty of our prospects. And because of that expectation, the federal government will have an important role in all of these different policy areas because they all touch the economy. Every single thing, no matter how much it doesn't seem like it's economic, right? Healthcare policy, I mean, the healthcare sector is a sixth of our economy. Obviously, that touches the economy. Immigration, education, energy. Energy is extremely important, right? Energy is one of the fundamental commodities driving the economy. Banking, the environment, they all touch the economy. And so the federal government is not going to recede, even if we get a decade of deregulation that's pushed by Republicans, even if we get a cutting of budgets that becomes more fiscally responsible, and therefore the federal government gestured to spending, which was on the board last time, does less spending. The centrality of economic policy is not going to go away, and therefore the federal government is going to have its hands on an awful lot. And because Congress can only do so much, even at its most efficient, there's going to be a lot going on over here. So that's kind of pointing you, as we end this class, towards the fact that Congress is not the end-all be-all of our system, and in order to be able to understand how our federal system works, you need to take a class in the presidency. You need to take classes on interest groups. You need to take all these other classes. So that's kind of my pitch for continuing the study, if you haven't already done so. Okay, well, that's the end of Module 3. I'm going to come back in a few weeks with a course wrap-up to try to tie it all together in, you know, one sort of neat bundle, if that's at all possible. But until then, this is the end of Module 3.